baseball players and athletes in general, people in general, don't like to use the term frustrated. But has this year been frustrating for you to try to find where you are?
I mean, at times, yeah. You know, I think, it's been a few pretty good talks with Julio and Woody and other staff members just about, different things, trying to, maybe figure out a little bit how I can take some of the process and turn it into results. I was told early in my career by Mike Pelfrey, we were talking one day, and we were just talking about days you struggle. It's kind of hard to sit back and say, man, you had really good stuff. And I just feel like, I've had too many outings this year where how I feel on the mound hasn't transpired into results and turned into the results that I feel like my stuff could have had that day, whether that's a few times missing location or kind of how it has been the last three starts. I feel like whenever I make a mistake, it's getting hit right now pretty good. And for the most part, when I execute, I'm getting pretty good outs, and if I could just keep the ball in the ballpark, we'd be all right.
What are your goals as far as what you want to do throughout the rest of the season? What do you want to get from the second half?
I don't think anything changes. I still think, you got to go out there and execute pitches and give the team a chance to win. My goal doesn't shift really much past that. Sometimes that looks like you got to throw up a shutout, and sometimes that looks like you can give up four or five and the team still has a chance. So I don't think that changes for me. I'm still trying to get better, still trying to work on, delivery and whatever it might be. We still got a lot of games to play, and we want to go out and win as many as we can.
Thanks, I appreciate you.
Yep.
Questions for Kyle, Evan. Please unmute yourself.
Kyle, when you came up with Minnesota, the Twins were kind of in the stages of a rebuilding process, and you went through that, I think, for a couple of years. What was the chief lesson as a young guy that you learned from all of that, and that might apply here if there's a significant turnover in terms of veterans tomorrow?
There were a few teams that we struggled pretty badly, I think that. I don't know that there's one or two key things that you try to remember or hold on to. I've been on teams where it's just a couple guys get traded, and then, I think in 2018 we had like eight or nine guys traded, and I don't think anybody had ever seen that. So, it's something that I started really kind of understanding, valuing the friendships and valuing the relationships that you build. Very rarely – or really never are you on a team with every 25 guys come back. So the team that you're on, this is the only time that you're going to be with that whole group of guys. So, and I think the main thing is to avoid big sales of the trade deadline, the best thing to do is to play well. That's that. Unfortunately, we just haven't done that. It hasn't panned out how we planned it so far. Now, like I said, there's still quite a few games to go, and we got a lot of good players, and to think that anybody in the clubhouse doesn't think we can't get back to 500 and be pushing close, I think that'd be an unrealistic thought for everybody outside the clubhouse to have, because we still believe in ourselves and believe we can go win baseball games quite a bit. It's definitely, as I have been through it a little bit in 2018, and then thankfully last year we didn't have to worry about selling. But as you go through it a little bit and you it becomes real that teammates and friends are going other places, you can sit there and you can blame the front office or blame other things, or you can kind of look at yourself and, hey, we just have to play better. If we'd have played better, then some of this wouldn't have happened. So but it's a lot of things that you can't control and that you can't get distracted by. And as a young player, if I were to give them any advice, it's every day you just got to go out there and keep working, and you got to keep getting better. And you never know when you're going to be a piece of one of those trades and it's going to change your career or give you a different opportunity. And you never know when a trade is going to give you an opportunity on your own team. So you always got to be ready and always got to be getting better.
Is there anything there's a good group of young guys here, right? Is there anything that any of those guys guys need to do to step up as a leader post this deadline, or is that not really necessary?
No, I don't think so. No, I don't think so. I think we got a good group of young guys and a good group of veterans. I don't think even if we trade nobody, I don't think there's anything that everybody or any young guy or veteran needs to do to fix himself or fix the locker room. I think we have a good group of guys, and how I would like to see it is I would like to see us stand pat and see where we finish up here in the next 25 games and see what happens and see if we can get on a roll and see where we end up. But, I think you never want to get ahead of yourself too much, so I'll refrain from, looking past that. But I don't think there's no need to put any more pressure on yourself as a young guy or a veteran to perform this way or perform that way or be a leader here, be a leader there. You just got to be yourself, and leaders end up being pushed into leadership roles instead of, stepping and bringing themselves into leadership roles, in my opinion.
You're a leader when somebody starts following.
I believe so.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Other questions? TR.
Kyle, your home runs are way up, but I know that's got to be frustrating for you. Is there anything you can put your finger on what's going on there? Because I know you're –
Yeah, I mean, honestly, TR, it's been a little frustrating because I think I just looked at it. I think over my last three starts, when I've given up six homers, I've got 19 ground balls, six fly ball outs, and six homers. Half of your fly balls are not supposed to leave the yard. So if I could get guys to pop those up instead of barrel them up, that'd be great. But I like today. I mean, it was on two of them were on first pitch breaking balls. I mean, whether that's just a decision by the Dodgers to the lefties, especially to, sit on first pitch curveballs. I do like to do, but it's not like I throw it 60% of the time. Other than that, I'm trying to think. The other one was just a fastball up that I, wasn't trying to elevate to Smith, and it ended up high. So that one probably deserved to be hit out. But I mean, when the second batter of the game goes and hits a curveball for a homer, it probably tells you a little bit of something on their approach, and then another guy does it later on in the game. So, and it hasn't just been one pitch. That's the crazy thing. So I'm not trying to dodge your question at all, but it's been you name the pitch, and it just seems like in the situation when I'm missing with a certain pitch in the middle, it's not getting mishit. It's getting hit hard. So hopefully over these next five or six starts, whatever it is, it'll even out a little bit.
Can you go into your relationship with Lance Lynn and just the impact that he has on you? Because he spoke pretty highly of you yesterday when we talked to him. So can you just go into the relationship that you have with him?
Yeah, I've known of Lance for a while. Obviously, we went to high school probably 40 minutes apart, never played of each other, but he was always the guy that everybody in Indiana knew about. He had the Lance Lynn folklore that still follows him to the day about his high school career and Little League career. So, and then played against him, I think, once in college, but so always knew of him and having a lot of family that live in St. Louis with his time there, knew of his career and knew how successful he had been. And was really excited when the Twins signed him in 2018 and actually getting a chance to be his teammate and get to know him. And, whether it's mindset-wise on the mound, where his head's at, how he approaches hitters. Obviously he's a guy that uses more fastballs than anybody, but he uses his off-speed in the right times a lot of times, picking his brain on what he does in those situations and how he makes that decision to go away from his fastball to his off-speed pitches. I think that's just some of the stuff on the field that I've got to know him better on. Off the field, we are the fortunate ones that kind of get to see a little different side of Lance. We get to see the dad side, the husband side, that type of side of him, the friend side, whereas, you guys don't necessarily get to look in on that. But, he's a guy, with his daughters, he's an awesome dad. And it's something that, whether we're always going through, these times together, especially when you're away from your family, trying to keep those relationships together and to get to know him on that level, has been really cool, and then just to appreciate him as a friend, you know, whether it's going through kind of this tough stretch I'm going through, whether he's down there watching a bullpen, seeing if he sees something, he just really cares about people, and he cares about the culture of a locker room. He cares about how teammates treat each other, and it's been a lot of fun being his teammate.